Ford, Equestria. Side story. Gardener. By Vanner. Chapter 3. To all things, praise. Today was Sunday. For every other pony in the wastes, this was another day of struggle for life. Whatever concepts of weekends the old world may have held, they meant nothing in the post-war society. Every day was laborious, and there was no rest. Here on the lot, Sundays meant work for me as well. Today, there would be no digging, no breaking of the concrete lot, bones would not be ground, and the earth would welcome home no new ponies. Sunday was a day of worship for our dear goddess Celestia. She had given us this day to rest when she still strode the world in mortal form. And it was up to me and a few devoted to make sure the world did not forget her. Services were held at noon just as the sun streaked through our stained glass windows. Ponies would come from the surrounding villages to hear me speak of our departed goddess and of return to her embrace. They came, enduring the hardships, the wastes, to hear me speak, and to receive the gifts I gave them. Surely, some were not interested in my message, but all who attended received the bounty of the land, believers or not. I had woken Charm early this morning to help me prepare. Her magic provided useful in filling bottles with clean water and sorting the bad apples from the good. This week's harvest has proven plentiful, and I was grateful for the opportunity to provide apple jerky to my congregation. A familiar crowd began to filter into the showroom, most bearing a small donation for the church. Their gifts would be given to those in need, or used to increase our production here. Gacho took their donations, thanking every pony in his own tongue. Kesa had washed the white linen robe that I used to preach Celestia's word earlier in the week. Some generous pony had donated a bottle of unopened bleach. We had used most of it to sterilize medical equipment, but Kesa had saved a catful to use with laundry. I chided her for such an irresponsible use of a gift, but thanked her for thinking of me. The sun climbed to its apex, and I took to my pulpit. The congregation that stood before me today was my normal crowd. There were new faces, as there always were, and faces of those who have been attending my masses for years. I had noticed one or two absences and sought out the families of the missing. Their eyes were heavy with tears, and I knew I would be called to their homes after the service. I cleared my throat to begin. "My brothers and sisters," I began, "we are gathered here today of the sun to give worship and praise to our goddess, Celestia. To those who have not been here before, I am Gardner, and I welcome you to my lot. I have but one request of you, and that is to listen to my message. What I have to offer is not much, but you may at least find peace in my message." I cleared my throat and began to talk about the miracles of the sun, and of the miracles of life in the wastes, how foals were born every day, and how their lives would work to end the wasteland that we have grown accustomed to. I reminded my congregation that we were no more than a generation away from salvation. If only every pony would give themselves to heal our world, we could crawl up from the ruins of civilization and become a new light to the world. I urged them to give, not to me or the church, but give to themselves, and give back to Celestia's message of love and peace. The mass ended quietly, as it always did. Kesa and Gacho passed out the dried apples and clean water to the parishioners as they exited. The ponies I had seen earlier approached and informed me they had brought their deceased to be returned to the lot. I nodded and followed them to their carts. I had more ponies to return to the earth than I had in weeks. The raiders 2 days ago, combined with the four who passed from the journey, and the three so kindly brought to me today, left a total of 12 to bury. Such is the life of those who called to bring home ponies. I accepted their families and promised them individual trees. I gave them additional water and food to help them through their troubled times. High above, the sun marched across the sky, beating down on the lot, baking the corpses of the less than freshly deceased. I normally avoided this work on Sundays, but it had been a busy week and I didn't want to attract the seas by leaving the charges in the open. I summoned Charm and passed her a sledgehammer. The unicorn was initially disgusted by the corpses and found it difficult not to heave at their stench. I reminded myself that the filly was new to this, and she had not had the time to come desensitized to the decay as I had. I dug in my bag for some salve and applied it under her lip. The sweet apple scent would prevent the stench of decay from sickening the unicorn, at least until we were done. A sledgehammer provided wholly inefficient in her teeth. She couldn't swing with any strength, and more than once she nearly hit me with a wild backswing. After a half an hour of pounding on the concrete, she had a little more than a few chips. Her talent apparently wasn't breaking rocks either. I slammed through the concrete with my specialized sledgehammer and broke up the chunks small enough for her to telekinetically lift into the cart. Each time she picked up a chunk of concrete, the pony-made rock shimmered and spat out a small black ball. The spheres, each no larger than a marble, rolled into the cart as they stacked the marble concrete. The exertion of magic was clearly getting to her, and she stopped after an hour to rest. I offered her some clean water and questioned her about the spheres.
"I really don't know," said Charm. "Nearly every time I lift something, it always spits out one of those black orbs. I've never found use for them, so I just throw them away."
I told her to take them to Gacho. If any pony could find a use for them, it would be him. When Charm returned, she assisted me in digging into the soft soil we had exposed below the concrete. Her magic was far more useful here, gathering up great scoops of clean earth and depositing them next to the hole. No black spheres fell out of her loads this time, and she gave me a confused look.
"Every time I moved dirt or rocks, I got spheres," she said. "I wonder what happened."
"I wouldn't worry about it," I suggested. "Less to clean up or to trip over." At once, I found myself wishing for a horn. I could triple my daily work with just one spell and fix everything around the lot. Perhaps Charm coming here has been more of a blessing from Celestia and not a test of my resolve as I had initially thought. Instead of being a temptation, and believe me, it was a temptation, Charm was a reward for my attempts to make the wasteland a better place. I had eased the burdens of life and death for the ponies of the waste, and Celestia had rewarded my generosity with this filly who could make it easier for me to give even more. It was enough to fill my eyes with tears of joy.
"Are you all right?"
she asked. She had been watching me think, and she had seen the tears in my eyes. "My young filly," I said, "you are a blessing far greater than you are aware of. I feel as if Celestia herself has smiled upon me and delivered you into my hooves. The work you can do with your horns so far surpasses what I could accomplish. I can only hope that you can stay here forever and take my place in the lot."
"Very kind words of you, sir," she replied. "I'm happy I can be of use somewhere."
She looked out on the tens of dozens of apple trees on the lot and the greenhouses that glittered like a city of gold.
"Did you build all these yourself?"
she asked. "I did," I replied. "The greenhouses protect the trees from the environments. The sloped roofs collect the rain. Once we know it's safe, it waters the plants and brings new life."
"But why bury the ponies?"
she asked.
Why so much effort for those ponies who would simply dump in the wastes?"
"Because life begets life," I told her, leaning on my shovel. "Without a small sacrifice, life will not bloom in the wastes. It is the same with your body, should you have foals. You give yourself to bring new life, in the same way ponies give lives to feed others. The bodies of those gone before us nourish the trees in their decay. Our own blood, sweat, and tears goes into the soil to raise the trees as if we were their parents. The fruits of our labors go back to the ponies to feed the next generation, and bring us one step closer to peace in this wasteland. I gestured out to the greenhouses, the lot, the buildings. It looks like I have so much here that I'm the richest stallion in Equestria. But none of this belongs to me. It's all Celestia's. By her grace, I am here, and I am successful. She has blessed me with her gifts so that I may give to others. I looked to her right in the eye. She had the most beautiful set of violet eyes I had ever seen, and I found myself lost in them for a moment. I snapped back to myself and remembered what I had wanted to tell her. I've given you my rules for living here, I said at least. There is one rule that you should know. Here we give. If a pony approaches you and asks for food, you give it to him. If he is thirsty, you let him drink from our well. You are here now because Celestia wants us to give more of ourselves. With your help, we shall provide. Charm nodded quietly at my words and continued with our work. In the span of a few hours, the ponies were buried and saplings planted in their graves. Tomorrow, Charm would work with Kesa, Gacho, and I, would stake down the greenhouses, and Celestia would shower the lot with her son. We all had our parts in this, and I hope that we could all be able to fulfill our pieces in making Equestria the land it once was. It had been nearly a week since Charm had arrived on the lot, an extraordinary long and frustrating week. Between the three of us, we had found out that she had particularly zero natural talent for anything. Case's attempts at teaching her cooking were met with a spectacular failure that forebode Charm from entering the kitchen again. Gacho had simply banned Charm from the garage after her attempts at rebuilding a cart were met with an explosion that took his fancy new water collector. That left her with a single option of becoming my aide. I found myself glad for the company she provided, even if she talked little. We walked to the perimeter wall. While piles of concrete slabs waited for Gacho and I to lift them into place, Charm pointed her horn at the pile, and it began to glow with a soft green light. The pale glow was the same light as a cloud of dust lifted from the rock. The cloud drifted over the pile and formed a perfect marble-sized sphere. We had been gathering these marbles for a week now. Every time she picked up something new, another marble. Gacho simply had no use for them. The balls were heavy and rolled fine, but they were too big to make decent bearings. We kept a bucket of them outside the garage, as not to trip over them. I questioned her as to the weight she could lift with her magic. As with everything else about the filly, it wasn't much. She had managed to levitate a cinder block worth of concrete into place, but could move no more. But something was more than nothing, and now Gacho no longer had to break out his lift every time he wanted to build a wall. Which was just well. That scissor lift scared me to death. I gave her instructions, and lifted her with a bag of mortar. I came to the wall to check on her progress after an hour. As it turned out, she was able to rebuild walls better than she was able to cook. That wasn't pretty, but really, what a wasteland was. The section of wall she had rebuilt was functional, and would keep out the creatures of the waste, pony and non-pony alike. I admired and praised her work. I kicked black marble into the lot. Perhaps we could find use for them today. Gacho rolled over to me, his face heavy with concern. He chattered something about the marbles that Charm had been producing. Gacho grabbed a handle of a yellow box and began sweeping around the marble I had kicked in this direction. The yellow box clicked and hissed like a rat roach on fire. Gacho recoiled from the sphere as if they were radioactive, which apparently they were. He demanded to know how she did that.
I don't know, sir, she replied. It just happens. I don't know how I could produce radioactive things like that.
Gacho swept his Geiger counter over the area of the wall that she had put into place earlier. The box remained silent. He chattered at me, grabbing my shoulder and shaking vigorously. What do you mean she can remove radiation? I asked. Do you really think that's even possible? Of course it was, he assured me. Magic can do nearly anything. We just need an experiment to confirm. I led the two ponies to our well, and drew a bucket of water. It was, of course, irradiated, as all groundwater was in the wastes. If you would please, I asked Charm, lift the water from this bucket. She concentrated, holding the water in a sphere above the bucket. Sure enough, a sea-sized pellet fell from the water. Gacho's yellow box glared the water safe enough to drink as I fished the radioactive seed from the pail. I looked at the tiny, danger seed for a moment, then back to Charm. She too stared at the pellet, her violet eyes filled with tears.
I'm sorry,
she cried.
I didn't mean to poison your water. I can't control this magic. I never could.
Poison? I asked. Charm, my young dear mare. This water is safe to drink now. You don't produce radiation, you remove it. My hooves were shaking in elation. Your gift has the power to transform the waste. With what you can do, the entire wasteland can become habitable. Sure, there are these mobiles to deal with, but... I stared out the wall and into the sky beyond the compound. You may be the hope of an entire generation. Together, we can rebuild the waste and bring the message of giving to ponies everywhere. I wanted to throw my arms around her and shower her in adoration. I wanted to bow at her feet and worship her as the gift she was. I wanted to raise this unicorn up on a platform and shout to the world that a savior has come to save us, to free us from the radiation of the land and the waters. But I could do none of this. Her gifts weren't a blessing to her. They were a curse. Outside these walls, she would be a target for raiders and slavers, and indeed any pony simply looking for respite from the radiation of our world. Otherwise, decent ponies would kill to have access to clean water and soil she could provide. Ponies I long considered friends and devotees of my message would gladly murder our family to keep Charm for themselves. I sat down in the dirt as the weight of this filly's gift finally came to me. Charm had gone from an unwanted unicorn to the biggest target in the wasteland in a single experiment. Gacho seemed to read my thoughts and asked me, what are we going to do next? Do? I asked. Gacho, we do nothing. Charm is a pony, the same as your and I. She will decide her own fate.
So you're not going to send me away?
She asked, her eyes again filling with tears.
Oh, goddess, no,
she pleaded.
Please, let me stay. I'll do anything.
Charm, you aren't going anywhere you don't want to, I said. I want you to understand what you can do, and I want you to understand how amazing your power is. If you can teach this spell to others, then you have single-hoofedly transformed the wasteland. Your power is to take away which kills us all. You can clean the soil, the water, the air. Nothing I could ever do can compare to that power, Charm. I looked at her, my own eyes filling with worry. At the same time, you are now a target. Ten Pony Tower alone would pay 1,000,000 caps to any pony who could bring you there.
Please, don't make me go back there, she begged. When my mother died, my stepfather couldn't afford rent. They threw us out and warned us never to come back. My stepfather took in drinking and blaming me for her death.
She looked down at the ground, trying to make herself disappear into the cracks of the concrete. They would kill 1,000 ponies to have you there now, I told her. Here, you're safe. You can do more than any of us now, and we can provide for more ponies than ever. I looked back at Gacho. He nodded, and made for the garage to make preparations. This calls for a celebration, Charm. An official welcome to our family. You are just listening to a reading of Fallout Equestria, Side Story, Gardener, Chapter 3, To All Things Praise, as read by DFatman. Hope you enjoyed this reading, and I'll see you on the next one. Goodbye, everypony.